Hi, and welcome to Building Build Tools. My name is Mike Smalley. I'm a senior systems engineer with over 10 years total experience in the field. I spent the earlier part of that 10 years engaged in traditional systems administration work, dealing with things like server hardware, data centers, and networking. More recently, I've been handling significantly more advanced operations engineering and automation work using tools like Chef, Graphite, continuous integration tools, and as we'll see here, Docker. I like to think this gives me a healthy mix of the traditional sysadmin wisdom needed to be level-headed about trends like cloud infrastructure, infrastructure automation, and metrics-driven capacity planning, but the foresight to recognize when fads are becoming more than fads. That is, to recognize that these trends are quickly becoming fundamental standards in any smart systems and operations engineering endeavor. I'm a proud member of the operations team at Wildbit, a software company that builds web apps to help software developers collaborate more effectively. At Wildbit, we have three products: Beanstalk, Postmark, and DeployBot. I've completed quite a variety of really interesting projects over the course of the past year, but one of the first and most ambitious projects I took on was the research, architecture, implementation, and ongoing operation of a secure, container-based backend compute infrastructure for DeployBot Build Tools. Before we begin, I'd like to give those of you who aren't entirely familiar with DeployBot a quick overview of what DeployBot is and how it works. Prior to the introduction of Build Tools, DeployBot could instantly ship your code anywhere in one consistent process for your entire team. DeployBot could deploy files, run SSH commands, or trigger webhooks. Now, with the addition of Build Tools, we've added the power of compute to the mix. Build Tools allows DeployBot to compile and prepare code on a Docker container based on an image of your choice. In essence, DeployBot can now transform your source code before you deploy it to your infrastructure, completing tasks such as code compilation, transpilation, conversion, or compression, to name but a few. You'll notice I have a picture of pancakes here, and it's not just because I like pancakes. I think it's a great metaphorical representation of DeployBot and Build Tools. If the plate represents our data centers, physical hardware, network, and operating system foundations, then the pancakes represent DeployBot, the application, and the berries represent Build Tools. Adding toppings to pancakes somehow makes pancakes even better. Likewise, the addition of Build Tools to DeployBot has very clearly expanded its capabilities and somehow made it even better. So, let's get into the individual components of our infrastructure. We've put a lot of tooling in place to make deploying our application stack simpler and more repeatable. Our entire stack runs on our own hardware. This helps us minimize latency, tune our own servers with different disk or memory configurations, modify our physical network infrastructure, or optimally use long-running servers or services, such as our relational application databases. Manually installing an operating system is not only boring and time-consuming, it's also error-prone. If you've ever tried to click through the graphical Red Hat or CentOS installer while working over an IPMI, ILO, or DRAC interface, you'll know that it can take quite a few minutes to complete the manual steps. It's prone to human error, and what's more, when the operating system is finally installed, there are likely more small changes that need to be made. For example, network interface bonding. This is why I introduced Cobbler into our environment. Cobbler is a fancy wrapper around the Pixie protocol. With it, we can install CentOS to a new physical or virtual server directly over our internal network using a standard kickstart template. It's become a huge time saver, and it allows us to deliver faster as an operations team. We chose CentOS as our server operating system as it's proven, comes with minimal surprises, and it's easy to keep up to date and secure. For configuration management, we use a tool called Chef. It can be used to define all of the intricacies of our infrastructure. It can handle dropping configuration files into place, installing applications, configuring and starting or stopping services, pretty much anything you can dream up. One of the more powerful, commonly used features of Chef is the ability to do searches on your infrastructure. You can run a search to get live information about your infrastructure and use the values returned in configuration templates. For example, you could query the Chef server and ask it to provide you with a list of all of the front-end web servers in your infrastructure that are running Apache, but none that are running other web servers such as Nginx, and it will be able to return this information to you for use in your own configuration files. It's a very powerful tool, and we use it to provision our servers once Cobbler installs the base CentOS operating system. Docker. It's constantly changing, it's not entirely time-tested, but it's very fast. That's a good thing in our case, as you'll hear me mention many times how important it is for us to swiftly bring up compute for Build Tools. Then we have the main attraction, DeployBot. The DeployBot application can bring up, monitor, and tear down Build Tools compute as needed. Finally, we use IP tables to provide another layer of security beyond what Docker already provides. It blocks all containers from getting anywhere except the public internet. It is also where NAT is configured so that all containers exit each host via a single IP. Here, I've listed the things I don't compromise on. Let's start with agility. Traditional virtual machines take time to start, and that's before provisioning them by installing any dependencies that are required to accomplish anything useful. There are four phases to bringing up a VM: starting it, provisioning it, running some tasks, and then shutting it down. Using a container, some of these steps are either not needed or happen very quickly. The speed at which we're able to operate directly correlates with the scalability of DeployBot, as more resources are needed, even if they're there to handle VMs that are in the process of starting or stopping. The quicker we can start and stop compute, the less physical and network resources we'll need to handle this overhead. We're not trying to build Amazon Web Services. For any given customer, we're bringing up a compute resource fast, running some tasks, then removing the container. It's what I like to call ephemeral compute. This is an intentionally simple view of our infrastructure. In it, you'll notice Cobbler is used to bring up a Docker host, a physical server that can run multiple Docker containers. Of course, one host doesn't cut it. We need to operate with scalability in mind. We're able to bring up compute for any of the thousands of customers using DeployBot today. Starting virtual machines is simply not as scalable as using containers because they require more hardware overhead to operate. In terms of the overhead required, containers are leaps and bounds less expensive than traditional virtual machines. Also, we made some careful considerations around how we wanted to handle networking that allow us to scale out rather easily. For example, internal IP space usage isn't something people may traditionally consider early on in the design of an application, but it's important in our case. The fact that Docker containers can use NAT to communicate with the outside world means we're able to use minimal IP space. Containers route out of one dedicated IP for a physical Docker host, while providing secure compute infrastructure for up to many thousands of customers. This is a higher level, scaled up view of our infrastructure. In it, you'll notice Cobbler is being used to bring up multiple Docker hosts, each able to run multiple Docker containers. Anyone who knows me knows that I strive for simplicity. This can mean goals like building stable, accessible infrastructure with equally accessible documentation. It can mean that each part of a system is decoupled from another part for ease of maintenance. It often means taking things away from a system that aren't needed or are burdensome to maintain. It's part of the reason I skip the use of some newer technologies where possible. We can still use the Docker API or command line tool to control containers on any of our compute hosts. There's no reason to needlessly abstract things by writing complex wrapper scripts when great tools already exist to manage Docker. If we were to have used virtual machines, this wouldn't necessarily have been the case. We would have needed to write helper scripts for some of the more complex administrative tasks that the Docker CLI makes easy. Here, you can see how a single machine, permitted through multiple firewalls, is able to manage the Docker infrastructure. Pretty straightforward. I've removed Cobbler from the diagram as it's used to bootstrap new physical Docker hosts. But once a host is configured, Cobbler is no longer relevant for the remainder of that host's lifecycle. As people submit their jobs to us for injection into containers, we can see usage patterns, and that allows us to think about the ways in which we can better optimize or expand upon build tools. For example, one trend we immediately noticed is people are using build tools for compiling JavaScript and CSS before deploying to their servers. As a result, we have images that include built-in dependencies. No waiting around for libraries to install in a container. The most common toolchains are baked in and ready to go. So what happens if we have a host and it has a problem? One of many checks will detect the issue in our monitoring systems and we're notified. Then, we can use the Docker API and command line tools to get insight into what is happening on that particular host. Bear in mind, a single Docker host can and will be running multiple containers. I always shoot for 100% availability. Obviously, in the real world, things come up that seemingly aim to crush this dream. Things like loose network cables or failing interface cards, bad memory sticks, simultaneous disk failures in a RAID array, and of course, the yearly data center-wide blindfold hide-and-seek tournament. And if such, we've got multiple compute nodes available. While the containers that are running on a Docker host may be lost if a host experiences a problem, only the compute is lost, not any important data. Your deployment configuration is still stored in the DeployBot application, and your code is stored in version control. Along the way, we saw a lot of different projects out there trying to solve problems for the Docker community. There really are some great Docker-related projects like Pipework or OpenVSwitch, which existed before Docker became popular. One of the things Pipework aims to do is provide a network layer for Docker containers to operate across hosts as though they're all in the same subnet. We opted out of these tools, though, as they didn't solve problems we have. So much of the tooling around Docker is in a state of flux right now, and we needed to ensure stability for our products. Our customers count on it. It's entirely possible some of these tools are stable, but they aren't part of the core Docker toolchain, and therefore, we opted out. That said, we're not averse to using these tools in the future as the community support grows, bugs are fixed, and more useful features get added. We'll certainly revisit them to see if they can help us improve DeployBot and Build Tools moving forward. It seems like over the course of the past year, there have been a litany of security concerns as containerization technologies become more popular. It's the same old song and dance, though. Not so much that security vulnerabilities exist, but that people are unaware they're running vulnerable systems. So what are we doing about it? We use what are relatively basic tools, things that have been around for a while and stood the test of time. Tools like IP tables, Linux user groups, that kind of thing. We spent time configuring and pen testing our own Docker configuration to make sure containers are isolated and secure at multiple levels. As one example, once they're started, containers are only able to reach the public internet to download any dependencies that they may need to accomplish their tasks. Here, you can see how each of the Docker hosts in our infrastructure is running IP tables. The diagram may be slightly deceptive, as it appears IP tables is only running on the public interface of the Docker host, but I assure you this is not the case. There exist fine-tuned firewall rules for all traffic coming in and out of each Docker host on all network interfaces. We also enforce things like disabling inter-container communication to prevent containers on a host from communicating with one another. The infrastructure was designed so that no two Docker containers can talk to one another. By default, containers on a host can communicate. Disabling inter-container communication prevents this. Earlier this year, there were some new tools released that can be used to audit a Docker host. One really awesome tool is Docker Bench Security. You can run this on any host running Docker 1.6 or newer, and it will test your setup, returning any warnings or issues it sees. Tools like this help stay on top of any issues with how a Docker host is configured. They aim to solve the problem of security vulnerability unawareness. Balancing security and convenience and functionality was one of the biggest challenges faced in the creation of this architecture. Another technique we employ is that we deny all access to the Docker hosts from any sources other than whitelisted IPs, and even still, authentication is required. Access is given explicitly, and it's tested. All of our security measures take place outside of the scope of the container, at the next layer up. For example, the daemon level, host operating system level, and network infrastructure level. We also employ VLANs to logically split up our network traffic into multiple independently secured tiers. The use of VLANs on their own should not be seen as a security precaution, but with tight access controls in the form of explicitly defined ACLs between these VLANs, they can be used as an additional security measure. There are quite a few fringe benefits that we're able to offer customers thanks to the fact that we use Docker as our compute backend. One I briefly spoke about earlier is that we can see common use cases and improve our base image based on these observations so that they include the dependencies needed for common tasks. This effectively shaves time and resources like CPU, memory, and disk I/O off of every subsequent use of that image. DeployBot affords you the flexibility to use your own images from the public Docker registry. And if you're using the same images in your production environment, you can be sure you'll have the same exact libraries in use in both your build environment and your production environment. Thanks for watching. If you're interested in how you can improve your deployment workflow with DeployBot, head on over to deploybot.com to sign up for a free account.